tonight a lecture about are my dogs playing or are my dogs fighting? Again, like normal, leave me any comments below if you do have questions. I will answer every single one of them. My moderator here has about a 5 to 6 minutes delay on the question, so be patient. People here, welcome. Like I said, today we're going to talk about the very scary difference between is my dog playing or fighting, and often it is very hard to see, and the interactions that we have or the interruptions sometimes in play can be devastating for your relationship with your dog. If your dogs are actually playing and you become a dick and then say you punish them for playing roughly, they don't understand it. Then one of the issues that we have with interrupting that play with kind of a aversive methods and us barking at the dogs and yelling at the dogs and you know, sometimes physically putting them apart might lead to negative associations to themselves. It's like, hey, did you do that? Or you motherfucker, did you make mom fight us? Oh no, I'm really mad at you. Yeah, so it's like the two kids that then blame each other for the rough play because mom got angry. Yeah, so it's a very, very difficult thing to do. And then often people, and we'll have some cute dog park play videos today where everybody is like, look how cute this is. And it's literally a murder scene building up. And one of the dogs in this film that you will see today actually dies in a dog park. And because people were thinking the dogs were cute, cute playing. Yeah, so often it looks like play and it's fighting, and then on the other side, it looks like very rigorous fighting, and it's actually the most awesome dog play you can ever see. And for many people, that is the biggest thing. So to prevent dog fights in a dog park, it's very easy. Don't go to a dog park. Yeah, I hate dog parks. It's like, you know, you walk into an insane asylum and you hope to find sane people there that your dog can interact with. And you also hope that some of these insane people are not dressed as sane doctors. Yeah, because some of these dogs are camouflaged nut jobs. So I'm absolutely against dog parks and having my dogs play and interact in dog park, because I have zero control over any of the other dogs, nor have I zero control about the education of the people that is handling these dogs. And so that for my dog, you know, I can expose him to an extremely dangerous situation. So I wrote many articles about, you know, dog parks. I actually closed two dog parks in California. There's the one in Pleasanton and one in Dublin. And I was working for TVAR in Alameda County. And there were so many like dog parks there that I petitioned the county and the city, and they just shut it down. And I hope they do that with a lot of dog parks, just to prevent you know, dogs getting put into a shelter because of other people's ignorance. So when it comes to dog play and dog fight, you could very much compare this with martial arts and real fighting. Yeah. So when we practice martial arts, we learn certain movements. When we go to the gym and we do Thai boxing, or you know, Savate, or you know, Kung Fu, or whatever it is what we like, we learn certain moves to defend ourselves. A self-defense class is the same thing. However, when you train or spar with your trainer, this is not a life and death situation. However, the movements, or in some cases the katas, when we talk about karate, are are basically fighting moves, yeah? And the vocalization that we, you know, we produce during that fight is also play. But, you know, when we come in a real fight, that training, those techniques often take over, yeah? Because now we are so confident in our ability, we know that we are able to defend ourselves because we play fought a lot and we had fun with our buddies. And now, you know, when we end up in a life and death situation, is because of the techniques, is it because of that play that everything, you know, that the fight, you know, looks like we are in the gym. Because if you see these MMA fighters sometimes spar, I mean, it looks like a real fight. However, they're actually having fun. You know, the same thing with the wrestler mania. Well, that's a little bit different. I wouldn't call that serious fighting, but you know, there's a lot of vocalization in there and there's a lot of acting in there that, you know, has the audience appear that somebody is in real pain. So with dogs, it's very similar. And so dogs from a puppy learn to play, you know, learn to fight, learn to defend themselves. They learn to wrestle with the mom. And the way they do that is by using their entire body. Yeah, they use their paws, they use their, you know, their shoulders, their back, their ass, they use their teeth, you know, and they communicate also with their entire body. You know, the ear position sometimes will be backwards, sometimes will be forward. The tail can be up, can be down, can be wagging, can be between the legs. There can be teeth showing, there can be growling, there can be vicious barking, there can be vicious growling, there can be spit flying all over, and the dogs are actually having tremendous amount of fun. On the other hand, in a fight, we can have the same thing. You know, we can have dogs that use their paws, we can have dogs that have their tail between the legs, we can have dogs that, you know, show their teeth, growl, bark, and basically use all the same language that we see in play, we see in fight. So for us as a human, it's very, very hard to distinguish what is a fight and what is play. And that brings me a little bit to martial arts again, and kind of to the more Japanese kind of style of fighting. When we think about karate, is the bow. You know, we're on the tatami and we're going to bow to each other. Dogs do exactly the same thing. They're going to play bow before that intense fight. And it's basically telling the other dogs that whatever comes now is a game. Unless, you know, I used my safe words and you're not listening to it, you know? And then it's the same thing, you know, in karate we have the three taps. And that means that please stop, release your choke hold because I'm literally out of breath. Yeah, and then if you're in a life and death fight, you can tap whatever, you know, whatever you want. I'm defending my life. This is the pass out time for you. If you do that in class, if you're sparring, you're a dick. Yeah? And so if I tap you in class and you're not going to let me go, I'm going to tap you again and say, hey, motherfucker, this really hurts. And if you don't stop, guess what? Now I'm going to come after you. And so that's how that sparring now becomes real, because you didn't hear my tap out. And I warned you, I give you a couple of warning signals. I say, hey man, this is not okay. And then I get serious, you know, I got a little bit of blue. You don't see the visual stimulation of my tongue hanging half out of my mouth and me grasping my breath and like trying to tap out. Well, at that particular moment, I'm gonna start defending my life. And now the so fun karate game becomes a real fight to the death, because I'm afraid of my life. So with dogs, it's the same thing. It's like dogs will bow, they have this play bow, they have this very rigorous game, and then, you know, can you imagine a tiny and little guy? Yeah, tiny is 10 pounds, hopefully, maybe a little bit more. He's 15 pounds, you know, and then I put a 100-pound German Shepherd next to it. So, you know, you have the size, this is tiny, and this is little guy. You know, and these are going to play with each other. Eventually, if they play bow and they wrestle, but then a little guy puts his entire weight on a tiny's little rib cage, the dog's going to say, oh my God, this did not feel well. And then the little dog's going to say, yapper-de-yapper-de-yap, I'm going to bite you a couple of times hard. So this was too hard. And then if the big dog says, well, I kind of like this ticklish kind of feeling, I'm going to pound you again, you know, and then Tiny does the same thing, just bites him a little bit harder and now goes for the nose and maybe bites him in the paws. And then the little guy is same thing, is like, oh my God, I love this ticklish feeling, what a funny little dog this is, and starts pounding a little. Eventually the dog will be so nasty and says, yeah, this is no fun and I'm going to get you. Yeah, and the reason why that is because, you know, that particular dog, little guy, did not listen to any of the warning signs. And there could be many, you know. And so, you know, that little terrier is going to say, hey man, I warned you 4 or 5 times, enough is enough. Yeah. Or sometimes what happens is you see it in a dog park. Yeah. This the dogs come and you got this, like, it's like cocky motherfucker. Yeah. That was his bow. It's like, I'm actually the bully here, but I'm just gonna pretend I'm gonna be gentle. So there's this little like bow, and then he starts playing with the dogs, and the other dogs already sense it. Yeah, it's like, oh, there's the asshole again. The guy that always need to show in the group that he's the biggest, baddest motherfucker. So we're not gonna play with him because he doesn't play by the rules. If we tap out, this guy's not gonna let go. So the dogs start avoiding them. It's like starting to run circles around him and say, oh, just stay away there a little bit, buddy. I don't like it. And then the guy comes closer and bumps into each other. He's like, hey, I want to play. I really want to play. I don't want to fight. I just want to play. Is this real? Dog says, no, man. I don't like it. No, not today. And then other dogs come around. Hey, motherfucker. I said, we're not going to play. Hey, but he's talking to me, okay? Not to you. Yeah, but I'm just here to help. No, I don't need your help. And then another dog comes in. They say, hey, what's going on here? You guys have a little call? And by without knowing, you have a big fucking bar fight. Because now everybody's mad at each other because one dog did not know how to engage play. And then all the other dogs were coming in and said, no, this is my game. Well, we're fighting this. Yeah, but I'm a little bit bigger than you. I'm here to help. I don't need your help, man. I was like, seriously, leave me the fuck alone. No, but I'm really here to help. And that happens with dogs. We call that ranking fights. Yeah? We call it ranking fights that might be initiated by somebody who initiated play the wrong way. And that happens in dog parks a lot. And we'll see one of the videos, and then unfortunately, you know, one of those members dies, you know? And then you have these people in the dog park. I said, he normally always plays really well. He's never done that before. And I just killed another dog. Yeah. So that happens in a bar fight too. You know, then eventually people get hurt, the cops come, people get arrested, your life changes, and bad things happen. It's because that one misinterpretation of initiating of a game and then not listening to avoidance signals. Yeah. So, in general, what we can say is that when we're playing, there will always be this play bow. And a play bow is not always, how do you call that, very obvious. Sometimes it's very fast, very small. Is this like, you know, these experienced senseis, they do, and that's it. But they know it's fine. We have a lot of experience sparring, so we're not going to do the whole official, you know, stretch my sciatic nerve out and show my little boo-boo, and you know, we're not going to do this. Yeah. So if we miss this as humans, and then we see this incredibly wild, you know, can you see Ip Man? Have you seen the movies Ip Man? One of my favorite movies on the planet. And then when he goes, and you know, when he's on his wooden man, I actually think he's wanting to kill that man. It's so vicious, it's so intense. that if he spars with these other masters, it looks like this fight to the death, but they're actually having so much fun. If I miss that little bow, oh my God, I could break up something incredibly awesome, you know, and then I would be a dick. Yeah. So, but in most cases, a play bow is pretty obvious. You'll see the dogs actually do it a couple times, you know. If you're like me and you're a little bit lazy and somebody play bows, I don't know, today I'm still, my back hurts a little bit, and then, come on, Ollie, come on, play a little bit. You see me do that sometimes on the floor when the dogs are a little bit anxious. I'll play bow to them a couple times and eventually, okay, let's do it. And so play bow in most cases is pretty obvious, but in all play, there is always a play bow. Yeah? That doesn't mean that you don't see it or that you see it. That means that if you didn't see it, well, you need to be watching a lot more other signs now. Yeah? The other very obvious thing, I'm sorry?
So it may not be obvious to us. Is it obvious to the other dog?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, is this obvious to you?
Yeah.
Maybe these guys in the back didn't see it, but you saw it, motherfucker. Oh, here. So, it's obvious play bow. Not so obvious. Yeah? So, one of the other things that we see in play all the time is the body is always supple. It's never tense. It's like a playing noodle, spaghetti's playing. It's always supple. The body is relaxed, the muscles are relaxed, the play is very fluent, yeah? You don't see a lot of stiffness. You can see heckles, raised hairs. We have raised hairs. Very important, these two. I'm going to put them in red or in green. Super important, these. But raised hairs, hackles, the like neck hairs go up. And then if you have a little bit of a wilder animal, the chest hairs puff out. Because the dog is what? He's excited, he's aroused, he's happy. And then people, as soon as the heckles come up, they're like, oh my God, they're going to kill each other. They're not going to kill each other. Yeah? They're just happy. It's like they're getting a hard on, playing. It's awesome. Yeah? Raised hairs is arousal. Whether it's sexual arousal, when it's chasing a bunny, whether it's playing, they are aroused, they are excited. Yeah? And it's not an alarm. Yeah, not an alarm. However, it's the neck and the front body. And sometimes the mid to end tail. Okay? That's play. And the front body, if you would have this, this would be where the dog's neck hairs stand up here, till here. And then this end here from the tail. Okay, bye. Okay. So the other thing that is happens is we're going to show teeth. We're gonna...
But on the raised hair, if Bella sees or hears or thinks there's a coyote outside, she will get heckled.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the difference between a heckle like that and just pure excitement?
Well, a heckles up with a coyote is also arousal.
Okay.
She's very excited about the coyote. Are we going to chase? Are we going to play? Are we going to mate?
Sometimes it happens if she doesn't even see, just smell.
Smell it, yeah, but smell is a stimulation, yeah, that's more important than visual. Remember tactile smell and then visual audible. So the dog will smell it first and then eventually will able to see it. You know, one of the things I always giggle with, I mean, I'm gonna make fun of probably some of you. It's like, I always giggle when people approach a dog and they do this. Because they reach out their hand because the dog needs to smell them. I mean, they reeked you 2 miles away. They know exactly who you are. It's fine. They know exactly what you ate, what your breakfast and dinner was. So smell is such a huge identifier that even if your dog does not have visuals on the coyote, they know it's there. Yeah. They know it's a predator because they can smell it, yeah? And they can smell it. I mean, some dogs can smell it up to 2 miles away, especially a bitch in heat. That's why so many males break out. And then you see them in the next village screwing another dog. And it's like, oh my God, it's like my dog's 8 miles away. Well, with a good wind that carries that smell, yeah, he can smell that female 8 miles away. And so they see if he runs up in the wind, the odor just gets stronger. It's like, you know, it's like 5 miles to the whorehouse, 3 miles to the whorehouse, you know, whorehouse next exit, you know, that's exactly, you know, what he's doing. Yeah. So hence, you know, as soon as she has that smell, she can start becoming excited. Yeah. She does not know the intent of the coyote yet. Because she can't have a visual. There's zero interpretation of body language. Yeah, but she can get aroused. However, if the association of a coyote smell of a predator or a squirrel or a rabbit is associated with some response. I smell a rabbit, what do rabbits do? They run away. What do I like to do? Chase it. When I have it, I like to crack their little backies into and eat it. Oh my God, super fun. Squirrels the same thing. What do squirrels do? Give us a little middle finger, run up in a tree and throw pine cones at us. So if I smell that, what do I get? I'm gonna run up to a tree, bark it, bite it, try to destroy it. Yeah. So as soon as they smell the squirrel, that entire film, you know, plays in their head and then we'll have that response. Yeah, just because of the associations that are made. You know, you go into your whatever laundry room where you store your chucket balls and you grab the chucket ball and the dog can't even see it. Now the dogs already get excited because you just took the chucket ball in your hand and the odor of the chucket ball became a lot stronger. And now the dog says, oh my God, this chucket ball's here. I know exactly what we're going to do. We're going to go in the car. We're going to go to a place. I'm going to see other dogs that I can bark at and chase it. And then we're all going to fly on a ball and then we're going to try to kill each other. You know, or you play in your backyard and you have fun, yeah. So, but teeth. So dogs will show teeth, and I'll see if I can let a couple of my dogs out today. We'll have a live demo, and my dogs are pretty rough players, especially my little 2-year-old female. She tends to terrorize my males, and then. Hopefully I can make it escalate a little bit, yeah? So we can see, hey, if I interfere, I'll maybe interfere on purpose, and then maybe I can create a little bit real fight, and then I can show you how to break it up as well, yeah? But teeth are always present most of the time. You know, they'll show a little canine, they smile, they growl, and then growling is always present, yeah? Growl. Growling is the same for us as talking, or it's a growl. You know, what else of the body is going to tell that the growl now is aggression? Is the growl, you ever seen the dogs that like start rolling over the ground and they're like growling all over the place because they're scratching their backs, you know, or they found the most awesome skunk shit and then they're rolling it and they don't, this feels freaking good. Yeah. So there's growls. Sometimes there's teeth. They're like, you know, they want to dig up the earth with their teeth because they smell something nice and there's growling. You think they're fighting the grounds? No. No, they really like it. So in play, there's a lot of growls. And these for people, that's why I want to do this in red. These for people are alarming signals. You know? It's alarming signals. So I have dinner with y'all and Daniel once in a while, and then it's almost every visit that Eyal would flash me the middle finger, you know, because of a mutual European joke that we pull each other, and there he goes, he gives me the middle finger. If I would misinterpret the context of the middle finger and then go break his nose, then Daniel would say, what crazy motherfucker is this? You know, this is the last time you're going to visit me. This is absurd. Yeah? So, and that is what we do as people. but that is what we do as people, yeah? That is what we do. We misinterpret, you know, the situation, and then, you know, we think that the, you know, if I tell him a joke, and then he shows me the middle finger, that I interpret that middle finger as something very seriously. It's like I didn't get the joke. And so if the dogs show these jokes to each other and we don't get the joke because we're out of context, we're dicks. The dogs tell him, I say, hey, May, don't come to my party next time because you're a little cuckoo. That is what happens. And now the dogs are doing what? It's like, oh, May's here again. Let's see if we can challenge her a little bit. Yeah? And then boom, it explodes. And sometimes dogs will do that. Yeah, to teach the other one a lesson. Like, just get out. Now we have our fight done. I can chew you out with the two, and now it's tag teaming. I've got the two dogs to one. That's what little guy and Popsy do with Riker, because they want to play together, but then the other one sometimes doesn't understand the growl and then growls for real, and then the two dogs is like, oh, let's get this stupid guy out of here. And then they actually go fight so they can play. Happens in dog parks a lot. You know, the two dogs that own the dog park from 5 till 7, you know, and then the two soccer moms' coffee is finally finished, and there's Claire coming with their little collie, and then the collie doesn't understand, and then she lets the collie go, and then, you know, Claire says, oh my God, look at him, and then they show this one little teeth, and now Claire goes completely insane because she saw teeth. And then what the other two dogs? There's a crazy bitch again. Let's just get rid of her, and then we can play and own the park. Happens all the time. I'll have video, you'll see it. Yeah? So, play bow always, supple body, raised hackles, neck, front of the body, mid and the end of the tail, teeth, growl, and what else? Barking. Lots of barking. And barking for people is also something that they don't understand. The dog shows all his teeth and barks really viciously to the other dog. Oh my God, they're gonna kill each other. No, they're not. They're just like, hey, you wanna play? Oh, I wanna play too. What game you wanna play? Wanna play hide and seek, or you wanna play fetch, or what are we doing? Well, like, bite you in the ass, you bite me in the ass? Or we're gonna grab each other by the neck and toss each other around a little bit, or what are we doing? Or are we doing the snow effect, the avalanche ball? What are we doing? I don't know. Rawr, 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 rawr. They have this like little discussion of what they're going to do, and then there we are. So they say, hey, stop. We're just discussing our game here. Go away. Yes, people do that all the time. Barking with play is what? Higher pitch. Sometimes fast, sometimes very rhythmic, so there is a kind of a sequence in the bark. and it can be very intense. It can be loud, can be, you know, I would say the volume, I'll call it volume variation. There's volume variation. It's very important. So now we have, you know, raised hackles, teeth, growls, and barks. Oh my God, that looks like an aggressive dog. So with fighting, and these are about all the signals. The one thing that we will see in the videos where we're going to pay attention to is the play ball and the supple behavior. This is most important, okay? So fighting. There's no play ball. There's more posture. Wanna play again? Come on, let's play. Ah, come on, motherfucker. Huh? Let's play, come on. Hey, let's play. It's kind of this kind of thing. Yeah? They have a lot of posture. The dogs are very... What's the opposite of supple? Stiff. Yes! Stiff. There's a lot more stiff movement. They don't walk like noodles, they walk like the kind of the Gestapo from the old days. What are you looking at? Wipe that fucking smile off your face. You see? That's what they do. And then you show me teeth, and I'm gonna freaking attack you. You see? You see the difference? And then you're gonna say, like, what crazy motherfucker are you? I said, I thought you were joking. And this is what happens a lot, yeah? So the big difference is the posture and the stiffness. However, it is not always as rigid as we think. It's like plus or minus. Sometimes it's only a small portion of the body that is rigid. Sometimes it's just the head. Where the entire body is like supple and still, my noodle is a noodle, but my head's very stiff. Sometimes it's only that, or the head's really supple, but now the back end and the tail start bushing up and gets a little stiffer. He's ready. He's putting his hips ready, and he's saying, oh, I'm going to go and jump on this guy really quickly. Yeah? So the rigidness can be part of the body. It doesn't mean all the body. Yeah? The posture is, you know, it's the body, yeah? Whole body. It's whole body posture changes. Yeah, parts of the body. So, the raised hairs is exactly the same. Plus the ass or the back. The back hackles will stand up. The tail is not the mid to end, it's the front. Mid and tail. And sometimes it's just the front with a supple body and stiff head, or it's just the end of the tail with a supple head but with a little bit stiffer backside or a little bit stiffer front side. But there's always a combination that's going on. Yeah? The ear position is going to be a little bit bushed out. He's going to put a little bit of tension on the ear. The ears are going to not move as supple. They're going to move a little bit more stiffer. Yeah? The teeth, exactly the same. The growl, a little deeper. A little bit more with oomph. Yeah? The growl, deeper. and I would say, yeah, how would you say oomph in ambition oomph? Yeah, like I mean it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Intent. I'll call it intent. And then the barking, low pitch. Not sequential. Arrhythmic. Biggest difference. So rather than wow, 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 wow. Yeah, rather rah 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 rah. I wanna play, 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 play. Yeah, that's it. Go there. Yeah, that's what it is. Big difference. So those, for me, are really good indicators. Between that. Okay, the hackles. Well, I need to be a little bit experienced and a little bit trained and have a really good eye to pick that one up. Yeah, if I need to see a lot of dogs before I'll start being aware of that. Yeah, the teeth, sometimes they're a little bit more pronounced. It's like the dog could throw his teeth forward. It's very hard to see. It's got everything to do with the stiffness of the lip. Dogs can raise their lip with a very supple muscle, and then sometimes they're really stiff. So this is a, and I don't have teeth, so I can't show you. But that is where the biggest thing are. So with the teeth, you see a little bit more stiffer lips. Yeah, stiffer lips. Any questions? Any questions online?
What about the eyes? Do they show the white?
Okay. So here we go. So this is fighting. We're fighting. So now we went from playing and we saw fighting. Let's transition to fighting. Yeah? So play transition to fighting. What do you think is gonna happen?
Excuse me?
Did you see the difference?
Oh, in your body?
Staring.
Oh, shit.
Exactly. Saw that one? See that one? Ah.
Stiffness.
Yes. You felt it, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah? So what we'll see is rather than eyes that go all over the place, I'm going to have a little bit more stare. Or how do you call stare in S-T-A? How do you spell stare?
S-T-R-A-R-E.
Stare, yeah. This is a French spelling. Okay, so stare. And the stare is more stiff. Right. He has this little thing that he does with his eyebrow, and then one eye gets really big. Yeah, that one. So sometimes the eyes are going to get a little bit bigger too. Yeah. Not always. The stare is changing. The other thing what is happening is the body gets what? Transitions from supple to exactly to more stiffer. Yeah, so the body is going to stiffen up. The movements are going to be what? More sharp, more square, not as round. Yeah? So body movement, more square. Oh. Oh, that's bad. Square. More square. What else is going to be happening? Not always. Why would the tail be up? Because you're proud, you're like a little peacock. Look at my little booty. Not always. Why would the tail go up? In what instance would a dog raise his tail?
Dominant communication.
Yeah, could be, yeah. So a tail, when a tail is here to here is dominance. From plus minus dominant confident to cocky. Yeah? But this is a dominant dog too, and a confident dog. Everything here, not so much. So this is minus to minus. And then this one, the tail here, is, we call that an SM, scary motherfucker. Yeah? Scared motherfucker. So that's the tail. But what's going to happen is you'll see the transitioning from a bushy end to a bushy beginning of the tail. That's what's going to happen. The growl is going to start going deeper. And you got the little lips, the tremors in the lips. It's not like... It's not showing all the teeth at once and they'll go growl, 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 growl. No, it's literally that little bit. And then they start shaking and then there's that little lip. And then you do the same thing. And then I go...
So when Rose
I'm sorry? Very arrhythmic, yeah. So the movement squares up. The tail starts stiffening. You'll see transitions in the tail. The growl, the teeth start showing a little bit different. You'll see the little tremors. Yeah, tremors in the lips.
Would the growl be the most obvious sign for someone who's, you know, kind of new to all this?
No. Stare, stiffness. The growl will not be obvious. I will show a lot of videos. I maybe one of you will have it right today in the growl. It's very hard. Yeah? It's like the three tenors, you know? And then are they singing baritone or are they singing tenor? That's a quarter key.
Yeah.
Can you pick it up? I can't.
No
sopranos in the mix, no. That would be obvious, yeah? Yeah, so if we would go from that high pitch to a very low pitch, then it's very obvious.
That's
so in that particular case, yes. Then the growl would be very, very obvious.
Okay.
But in most of the dogs, you know, and then, you know, look at a growl from like tiny to a little guy, it's just a vocal cord difference. So his growl is going to be sopranino to soprano, and then little guy is going to go, you know, from a baritone to a tenor, you know, or to a tuba.
So aside that everybody's saying they love the demos, they're getting the feedback. Amy's asking, for dogs who have tails in the up position naturally, what do they look like when they're showing dominance?
Nothing. That's the problem with the... breeds that have the natural tail. They only... thing that you could see is maybe the ass puffs out a little bit, or when they're really scared and neutral, the tail will come down in certain things. And then we've seen that actually with Lilo, where she drops her tail. If she's just happy and normal, there you won't see a lot. Yeah, so the same with the breeds that have their tail docked. Yeah, I'm big against docking of tails, because we take all the communication away. The same with cropping of the ears. We can't, you know, and hence it's illegal in Europe to crop ears and dock tails unless you have a severe medical reason to do it. But if we take that, we take the communication away. Hence, so many pit bulls and Dobermans and Rottweilers and Mastiff ends up in dog fights with other dogs. And why? It's because I'm showing you the middle finger. See it? Oh, you don't have one. Oh, motherfucker, it's not my fault that I don't have hands. And that's what happens. They can't communicate anymore. We're literally taking the ability of communication away. And then the other dogs that are normal, they say, like, I never. That's weird. Never seen one like those. And dogs are not like us. Like, it's like, oh my God. Poor guy's in a wheelchair, lost his legs, has no arms. You know, it's like, it's kind of weird. They're not natural. It's just going to bite him. See what happens. He's not fighting back. Oh, he does not have hands and legs. Oh, let's play a little bit rougher. Oh, he makes squeaky sounds. And then it happens. It's very unfortunate because that's what happens in the dog world. Yeah, and it's a human problem because we initiated that. Yeah? And so, but eventually what happens is that, you know, when you see these pit bulls together, they're like, oh my God, my pit bull's awesome. He plays with a lot of other dogs. Well, the majority of all the other dogs is probably other pit bulls or breeds that have a cropped ear and dog tail. Because they know how to communicate with each other. It's like the sign language for the deaf. You do that with me, I have no fucking idea what you're saying. I can kind of see your your emotion and your expression, but if I'm completely off and you're going really fast and you're laughing at me, but you're calling me a crazy motherfucker, I can't say it. And so I think the bitch doesn't like me. Kaboof! And I go on it. Now I have a problem. Does that make sense? However, if I talk to another deaf person and two deaf people talk to each other, I mean, have you seen this sometimes? It's like, oh my God, like I'm jealous. It's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. And even deaf mutes have sounds developed that they understand. It's like this, like their own little hidden language. So with dogs that have cropped ears and cropped dog tails and cropped ears, it's the same thing. It's like they're like the Masons here. It's like secret society, you know. We can only communicate with fellow members, you know. And then you bring in Fluffy, the Labrador, that can't even put his ears up, with a dog that has cropped ears, the Doberman. The Doberman always says, I'm a badass motherfucker, even though I shit my pants. And the lab is like, I'm actually a silly little guy, but I'm actually a crazy motherfucker. And then these guys don't understand each other. And then the lab says, oh, okay, why are you dominant? I just show you I'm dominant. And the Doberman is like, you're dominant? You just like look like a jelly bean. And then kaboof, they're fighting. And it's because of that lack of communication. Yeah, now we have an issue. And so so we see with altering the body that a lot of dog fights are happening. Yeah, hence I'm absolutely against it.
A question about the tail.
Yes.
You said when it transitions to fighting, the tail will push up at the base.
Yes.
But it's okay if it pushes up at the end.
Yeah. Yeah, but in play, you will see when a dog is in high arousal state, like chasing a rabbit or even chasing your ball, if you really look at little guy, in my, I have a slow-mo in my two ball video where I call little guy off a ball and he does this like big sliding and you can literally see his tail bush up when he looks at the ball. And then he basically gives me the middle finger because I call him off the ball. And it's like, okay. And then he sees me and he knows he gets his ball. You can see that tail bush up. The base of the tail stays perfectly flat. Yeah. So every time we deal with high arousal, that tail goes off. However, we have we have those transitions. Yeah. And those transitions, however, are not always subtle. And then I go back to my tapping once, tapping twice, tapping three times, hey motherfucker. And so sometimes it takes a while. And it's very difficult to start seeing the escalation process in transitioning from play to fight. Yeah? So with your thing, it's like, hey, did the guy literally didn't hear you? Could be. Hey, you know, instead of tapping on the ground, maybe now tap him on the shoulder because he might have not heard it. And then, oh, sorry, but you did this? Oh, yeah, man. Okay, we're all good. Yeah? And if they're in this, sometimes they have this protective gear, you know, well, what they see with a full contact taekwondo guys, they have this padded stuff, and now I pat on the padded stuff, and the guy still didn't respond. Was this malintent? No. Did he want to fight me? No. He didn't get it. And so it's trying to see that escalation process. Yeah? That is really, really hard. But the signals, stare, bigger eyes, body stiffens up, movements are more square, the tail gets more bushy, and then the growl changes more to a deeper growl, and the bark, yeah, starts slower. It's like less a less faster rhythm, but it's going to be arrhythmic. Sometimes there's fast barks, sometimes there's a couple barks. Sometimes there's a little pause. Rather than wah, 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 wah.
Or what about nipping in play?
Oh, hang on. This is just language. Then I'm going to teach you how they play.
Okay.
Yeah. I always tell people when they do the nipple off game, you know, the little and then they get your nipple like, God damn! And then like half your nipple's off. You know, that's play, but it hurts like a motherfucker. You know? I'll come to that point here in a little bit. Yeah. So arrhythmic. Yeah? So, and it's that. That's the art of stopping a dog fight. Because once the dogs are fighting, you are too late. So it's very easy eventually to say, hey, these dogs are playing, these dogs are fighting. But it's preventing that dog fight. That is the key. That is the art. And it's when you do that really well, if you manage play well, then it's you can create this incredible trust in your dog because you are what? An amazing teacher. And that is what the pack leaders do, yeah? The breeding male and the breeding female and the aunts and the cousins. That is what they do really well, is managing that game, is teaching all the other members of that social group in what the rules of engagement are. Because they're not the same in every social group, you know? You know, I come from a family of assholes. I say that all the time, yeah? So my dad was an asshole, I'm an asshole, my grandpa was an asshole. So we play asshole games, yeah? That means that we're not always playing by the rules. And just have this, sometimes this little nag is like, hee hee, I got you, motherfuckers, like, nipple off a reel, hee hee, just a band-aid, man, plug the hole, you're not dying, yeah? So it's like the rough guys play. We hurt each other a little bit, but we can still laugh about it, yeah? And then, you know, my cousins, they come from wimpy planets. You know, they go, oh, God, little owie, don't do that. Yeah. Can we play with the towels? We do origami with the towels, so we don't need to touch each other. That's fine. If you come from that social group, then this is your game. If I then, as a bully, come into your game and I play my game when we play origami with the towels, what am I? A dick. So why am I a dick? Because I don't play with the same rules, boundaries, and limitations that is set in the game. The rules of engagement have changed. And that is a big problem in dog parks, you know, because there's the soccer mom club, yeah, and their dogs have been playing forever, you know. There's like, oh my God, I got a little mud on my paw. I'll lick it off for you. And then they go, and then there's Benny the hunter, you know, with his big ass black lab. He's like, oh my God, look at this. It's like a bowling pin. And he runs into that group of dogs and all these dogs shatter. Yee-hee! Benny's here! Yeah. And then all these little dogs are like, oh, I think I broke a nail. It's awful. Oh, I think my mascara ran out. You know, and then they're all mad at Benny. And Benny says, this is how I play with the boys. And he says, no, this is not how you play in the social group. And then all these little fluffy dogs are going to antagonize Benny a little bit. And then Benny eventually says, like, try to be nice to the bitches, but this is about it. And then kaboof, he initiates a fight. Happens all the time in a dog park. And the reason why is if your dog, like my dogs play really rough, yeah? Your dogs play rough, yeah? And then you bring them into a group with, you know, on my paw. Then you got to fight. Because Benny said, this was not intentional. I've been doing this my entire life. It's not his fault. You're not an appropriate bowling pin for me, you know? And then we have a problem, yeah? Or we've got the loud mouths, yeah? So sometimes I see these dogs play and they're super silent. They're just like not vocal dogs. They're not vocal dogs. And there's Riker. Rah, 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 I'm here, rah, rah, rah. And it's like, what the fuck's going on? Yeah, like, holy smokes. And it's an instant dog fight. Because we had a dog group that is not vocalized, and now we bring us in this bully, and these dogs are literally shocked, you know, because we interpret it. Or, and this is where the problem lies, this is where we have a lot of initiation of this. When you're in the soccer mom group, and you see Hunter Benny with his spastic lab that's super loud, come here, Fiona. Good job. Stay away from that asshole. And then what we do? What did we do?
You made the dog bigger.
I made the dog super dominant. Super dominant by picking it up. And then I also reinforced the little lip that goes on, eh? And then the spitting. And then the little chihuahua is going, showing his little like mini teeth to the lab that's like, you want to play? And then they say, oh my God. And then they see the lab calm down. And then they put little Fiona back. What do you think is going to happen? Fiona's going to attack the lab because you just told her to. By picking her up and telling her that she's a dominant little bitch. And then the black lab's like, what the fuck? You said, I just told you you're okay. You can be dominant. Just don't bite me in my fucking ass. And then he turns around, stomps her a couple times. Now we have a dead chihuahua. Yeah? It's because our interference as humans was completely wrong. Yeah, we picked up a dog. You know? Then we have the moms that's going to protect the dog. I should have a dog, actually. I don't. But anyway, and then what they do is they're going to protect the dog, but they're lifting the front paws up. And then they're standing like this in a dog park. So what are we doing? What is front paws up?
You're exposing the belly.
No, I'm a big motherfucker. I'm going to stand up a little bit. Look at me. Yeah, I'm making my dog extremely dominant. So here I have this little dog with his tail between the legs doing this, yeah? Oh,
there's you with your black lab, I don't like him. And then mom's gonna lift him up and create this like dominant little. So there's Goose looking at this like trembling little thing with his tail between the legs, but he's standing up. It's like oh, that's a, this guy's a bipolar. I don't trust him. I want to test him. I want to do a little nippy nips and see how he responds. And then we can have two things. We can either have a dog that says, oh, you're actually not that bad, or you say, oh my God, you're actually an asshole. And we made a dog that's actually anxious. We made him falsely dominant to the outside of the world. Very bad. Yeah, very bad. So our interference in that transition phase can make the difference between play or fight. We can turn a little bit tense moment into the most fun game, and we can turn a little bit tense moment in a fight to life and death. And that is all about us interpreting what is going on and how we interfere and what do we do as a human. Yeah? Yes?
Once our dogs cross this puppyhood, is this process of communication static or they adjust?
It's dynamic. Yeah, dogs learn each other's play, play style. See it as somebody who does judo and somebody who does karate. They have the same, it's both Japanese martial arts. But it's very different. They have very different styles. But after they learn to play with each other a little bit, they'll adapt to each other's styles and they'll be okay. But it takes a little bit of getting used to. They're like, oh, I didn't know you can punch. Judo has a little bit of punching, you know. And then karate has only a couple of choke holds, where the judoka says, well, I got 180 of these and you got four, you know. And so it's like, if you then set rules and then dogs do that, to say, hey, let's play within our mutual kind of understood way of playing, then you have an awesome game. And then when they get older and they play more with each other, they get used to each other again, and now the game becomes more intense and more intense and more intense. So dogs will do that. Yeah, they set really good communication guidelines and rules of engagement within each other. It's us as humans that, for instance, Rupert and Bella. I remember the first time that I put Rupert and Bella together, there was this overprotectiveness. I said, oh, she's going to hurt her little paw. She might hurt her hip. And then, oh my God, poor Rupert is going to be gobsmacked because Bella is so intense and going to be all over him. And it's that worry from the beginning that we sometimes jump in a little bit too early because, oh, we are overprotective over our female, or we, oh my God, poor little Rupert, poor little guy, he's going to be mauled by Bella. And then, you know, when I say, it's fine, just leave him a little bit. Just everything is still supple. When it's supple, nobody gets hurt. And then you'll eventually see that game, you know, mellow out. Might still be intense, but for the dog's fine. You know, the dogs are like, okay, you're allowed to chase me, you're allowed to bite me in the ass, and I'm not going to do anything back, and just take it. Is that fine? Yeah, if the dogs like that game, that's fine. And that's what kind of developed between, you know, those two dogs. And now when they're with each other, they know they have a very steep, intense start, and then it kind of mellows out, and then it goes back to intense, and then it mellows out a little bit, and then it goes back to intense. And the reason why that works is because we haven't interfered on the wrong time. If we would have been overprotective, you know, with those two dogs, maybe Bella said, well, every time I'm a little bit intense, my dad punishes me. Or then Rupert says, oh my God, every time I chase her in a certain way, she started yiping, and then I got grabbed by the dad. Well, next time I grab her a little bit harder, give her a reason to yap. Sometimes that happens because of what we do. Yeah?
So at home you never interfere?
Oh, yeah, of course I interfere. I prevent fights. That's what I do. I prevent fights. There's no fighting in this household. on that is it. Sometimes dogs get a little boo-boo when they play. Yeah, that's what boys do. You know, girls break nails. Not a big deal.
Ask, are you going to tell us when and how to interfere?
No. That's $1,000 extra. Yes, I am. That's why the videos are there.
Do you ever have a pair of dogs or a couple of dogs that you trust to just leave unsupervised, or do you always try to be present if they're all together?
You leave three toddlers unsupervised in your house?
Not toddlers, but...
Okay, then. There's my answer. Dogs are toddlers, yeah. They have the mental capability of a five-year-old. Would you let your five-year-old manage the house by himself all the time? Or a couple of them? One might be okay, but a couple together? But yeah, I try to supervise my dogs all the time. Does that mean that I'm like a hawk? No. Does that mean that I can let my three dogs play on the training field an hour by themselves? Absolutely. Would I leave those dogs 24/7 by themselves? Not really. It's not that they're going to kill each other, but they might discover that digging holes and yanking tree roots out is the most fun thing to do together. And now I don't have an orchard anymore. It's not the fear of fighting, but it's the creativity that dogs will get together, you know? And that's when you come home and you see, you know, you have couches with three pillows, but everybody has chewed a little den out of it. Because they saw one dog doing it, and it's like, oh my God, are we playing this game now? This is awesome. Let me do this too to this one. Hey guys, there's a sleep number bed. It's really cool. Yeah? And so that is the issue, yeah? So, and the reason why, you know, it's so dogs can play unsupervised very well. You know, especially my three, I can let them hear in the garage and they'll be fine. However, one of the risks that we always have is that innate behaviors will take over. Like if we don't supervise our dogs, you know, whatever it is they're doing, eventually they're going to say, like, you know, I'm a terrier. I do terrier things. And remember what terrier things were from my previous lesson? Yeah, we dig holes and go in small places and try to kill stuff. You know, and then you come home and then all your parakeets are dead. Because he got in the cage. He thought, oh, that's what I do. I like to chew things. And parakeets make noise. And then when you bite them, the noise is gone. And then you go over to the other parakeet. So that's the issue with letting dogs by themselves. So I would always suggest have supervision. Leaving a dog in a yard that is not controlled, and when you're gone the entire day, yeah, you have no idea what he likes to do. And then you come home and you grab the balls. And you want to play. You have a question?
Oh, no.
Okay. It's just a sore arm.
Yeah.
And then you want to, you bring your chuckets, and the dog is like, chuckets? Let me show you something. Forget the chuckets, dude. Look what I can do with your fence. You know, or look what I can do with your lawn chair. You know, see what I did with a pond. You know, it's awesome. Like, I made belly floaters from the fish. And that's what happens. Yeah? So when we let dogs by themselves, or, you know, you let a Malinois out by themselves, like, you know, just check my orchard every year. Every year I have Malinois. I let them by themselves for an hour and a half. It's a freaking minefield of holes. Because they're diggers, they're natural diggers, you know? So if they start, developing games by themselves, and they then have a body language to that game. Like, for instance, Bella, when she attacks the tree, it's very vicious. If she would attack a dog like that, he'll probably fight back. But the tree says, I don't fight back. And then the dog can actually, like, destroy the tree like he's playing, but if the dog would show that body language to an actual dog, then we have a problem. And that sometimes happens as well. So dogs that, you know, they're pretty good, they're socialized, you bring them to, you know, you bring them to your friends, and they don't really play intense, but then at the home they develop this like weird game, and they have this like weird aggressive way of playing that they sometimes try on other dogs, and then we have a dog fight. So I would always, you know, have some form of supervision. Any questions? Any comments online? Nothing? Is that thing still live? Okay. Judgment Day. Hello. See my guest, Caesar Milan. Okay, first scene, very, very quiet scene. It's two dogs growling, and it's two dogs playing in the snow. So we're gonna watch this clip a couple times. So there we go. I'll turn it up a little bit. So what was that? What did we see? But what do we see in the video? They're supple. They're very supple. Their bodies are flying everywhere, and the growl is pretty low key, you know, not intense. So the other issue with this is what?
Jacket.
Ah, yes. Oh, you said jacket? Yes. Sorry, I gave you credit. So, what do we hide with a jacket? Communication. Communication. Yeah.
Let's do it. I also saw one dog put a paw.
Yeah, let's do it again.
And the other one avoided it.
Yeah, let's do it again. Let's watch this again. Okay. What's the dog breed?
One looks like a Pitbull Mix and one looks like the Lab Mix.
Yes. But what is the anatomy of these two dogs? There's two dogs with stiff tails. They're not like our German Shepherd. They're not fluid. They're just anatomically very stiff tail. So when they're going to wag it, what is this going to do? A little bit stiffer than other dogs, because we need to look at the play. If you look at this picture, and I would have just shown you this picture, what do you think would happen?
They're gonna fight.
If you see this and you didn't see the video and you saw this photo on the internet, what do you think was gonna happen? Half of the people are gonna say, oh, these dogs are fighting, and half of the people are gonna say, I have no freaking idea. Say again? Exactly, I have no idea. But, and you know why? Because of this. Mm-hmm. The dominance in the mouth, the ear, the tail is up, it's bushy, and what is this guy doing?
He's down.
Mm-hmm. What is he doing? Bowing. Oh, my bad. I don't know anything about technology. And then we missed it. That's what I don't like about Apple and YouTube, is that you can't slow motion back and forth. What happened right there? I'm gonna play it again. There he goes, there he was again. There he was again. There it was again.
Wrestling.
What?
Wrestling.
He bows! Oh. They're bowing to each other. It's supple and they're bowing. They don't land on their feet and keep themselves up. They go and come up. There you go. Did you see it? Yeah, they're not. They're just communicating on the lips.
This is.
Okay. So, 16 second clip. What have we seen in this clip?
Bowing.
Supple bowing. Supple bodies. What else? Hackles up. Where? Neck and tail. And growling. Yeah. We saw all of it. Remember my list, the five things? We saw all five. All five we saw, except for number six. What did we not see?
Barking.
Okay. What have we seen? This was 14 seconds.
A small dog park.
What behavior have we seen?
They're not engaging with each other.
No, but what have we seen? If somebody's coming in with a camera, and what did all dogs do? Stop what they were doing, looking at the camera, and some dogs are following and some dogs are freezing. That's what we saw. I'm gonna play it one more time. What the fuck are you doing? This is a what the fuck look.
He's all the way in the corner.
Yeah?
He's like, no.
What else is going on with this dog? The wide eyes. Okay, I'm gonna show you 1 second. Did you see the surprised look? And it's like, hey, what are you doing? Hey, what are you doing? And then you see these guys? It's like, oh, fuck. What are these guys doing? What is this guy doing? He's looking at this guy. And then that guy's like completely oblivious. Yeah. And then ears up, ears sideways, ears at 3:15. Pretty confident in what he's doing. Pretty confident is what he's doing. Well, this is a little bit of a mixed breed, because he has this curl in his tail that stands up. So we can already see that. This little Jack Russell's pretty young. What's the wagging of the tail?
He's really supple, right?
Yeah, but it's...
Excitement.
Yeah, it's arousal, yeah. It doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean he's happy. It's just communicating. I'm communicating, he says. And what is he communicating is what's here, yeah? So what is the guy, what was this guy communicating? Well, it's an aggression class, but you know, when I see these things, I want to educate you guys a little bit about. Okay, let's focus on this one, yeah? What is this guy communicating? What is he communicating? I'm communicating that I have no idea what the fuck's going on. That's literally what he says. What is going on? What is going on? Yeah, he's not happy because he's avoiding me. He's not like, oh my God, you're the most happiest human in the planet. He's like, oh my God, what's your intent? Intent, you say, I scared you. Okay, what are we seeing? Yes. See my Facebook post between cats and dogs?
Yes.
Yeah? You never seen it? So, German Shepherds. Okay, it's my dog, little guy. So German Shepherds, you know, you can train them for protection, you know, obedience, they do search and rescue, they're a good companion, they can find, you know, the smallest amount of drugs, and cats, they shit in a box. You see that supple puppy? Oh, don't do it. Don't do it. So a supple puppy and a little stiffer guy here. Watch this. Imagine having goose in there. Thank you.
buddy. Good boy, buddy.
Okay, did you see it?
To what we just saw when the big yellow dog was sideways to the other start of that dog getting a bit of pissy.
Which big yellow dog?
The first one, I think, is what they were talking about.
In the snow, I think.
In the snow? He didn't get pissy. There's no pissiness. There's just intense play. The growl wasn't pissy. It's just intense play. We'll go back to the video at the end. You see it, yeah? See the little bows that the big dog's doing and these guys. Very subtle.
Hey Ben.
There's a bow, but yes, he put the paw on the back, which is a dominant move, but then after that there's a little bit of a bow. He say, I'm dominant, I'm bigger, but no bad intent here. Typical ranking play, this guy bowed, this guy's bowing. Bow. Bow. Bow from the shepherds. Food. Bow from this guy, bow from the boxer there. Bow from the boxer again. Stiff guy, yeah? The little one? Mm-hmm. Hang on. Oh, I did it again. Sorry, I don't know how to operate this.
Attention, do you have Medicare? Did you know that you may qualify to get up to $144?
Sarah, I'm taking a break. Taking a break, good girl. Pipes, go girl. What you doing? Good girl, Murphy.
A little dominant. Don't watch that one yet. So, what did we see? How is this dog carrying itself? He's very secure about himself. He says, I'm very confident here. Little pippies, little markings. Maybe. Still stiffens up. Mm-hmm. And the owner just called his dog. Yeah? Was a good recall. Okay, did you see what happened in the last 30 seconds? Mm-hmm. Sorry.
What's this? Lights too.
Yeah. Is this supple or is this square? More square, yes. And he's also... Mm-hmm. Might be the grass. While he's walking around the dog already.
Maybe.
What is this guy saying? Man, this is, I mean, I told you already, you're the boss, leave me the fuck alone.
Hey, Nick.
Another pee-pee. Hackles are up, yeah? Just they're all aroused. However, guys, and now I want you to pay very close attention. There it is.
And it was down his back a minute ago, too.
Yeah, no, I was going to say.
It transitioned from here in one turn, and it's here. If you see that, you'll see what's coming. This guy runs supple, is in circles. This guy runs really square. He blocks the dog constantly.
He's getting bullied.
Who?
The little guy.
The little black one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No pun intended. Clobber.
Nasty.
It's really targeted him. Maddie, come here. Hey. Females. Don't know how to act. Let's go. Sit. Let's go.
What is he doing by holding his dog like this?
Frustrating it.
Ah, yes. A little bit of agitation. Yes, what do we do in protection? Same thing, we back tie the dogs a little bit, create a little bit of frustration. And then what did he do when the German Shepherd just came and say hi? Kubuf. What did the German Shepherd think? Aha. I might be having a little chance here.
This one. This one.
So why is the dog not listening here? For everybody who saw my videos? Overshadowing, yeah? Salience, salience of stimuli. He's buried with his nose. There's no way he can hear us. Yeah. So yelling at this dog has at that moment no effect. No, no, true, yeah. Okay, so a lot of things have happened in the last 20 seconds, and I want you to start figuring out what it is. This is a big sign that your dog should not be there. And it just happened. If you haven't seen it, we'll try again, but the top score is going to lower and lower. Okay, cool. Let's not watch the area yet. Okay, let's watch it again. Now, I was once a half second too late when it paused. I'm going to watch it again. I'm gonna watch it again. There it is again. He raises his back, hackles, and bushes his tail out when he's running over piss.
Okay, I thought I saw the little tail.
What is your dog doing? He's preparing for a ranking fight. I do not like this. He said, I'm the biggest motherfucker on the block. Guess whose little pee-pee it is? The German Shepherds. Did you see it? Did you see how bushy his tail, and then he smells something up, and it goes away. There it is. He smells pee and whoop, raises those hackles. And it's like a rudder plane, yeah? That's how fast it goes. Do you see it?
He just marked over.
Oh, yeah. That's a ranking fight in making. Sorry, we got ads, guys.
This is Cowboy and Otter. Thanks to Wisdom Panel, we now know they're part border collie, with a genetic marker for medication sensitivity. Wisdom Panel is the most accurate dog DNA test. Know more, care better.
No sponsors. Oh, and now we have a poor dog that has what for tail?
Upright.
Yep. And what is the pit bull gonna think from the upright tail? You're a dominant motherfucker. And what just happened?
He got super stiff.
Posture. Yeah, posture. How many play bouts did this guy give already? Three. Yes, three. What does this guy do? Exactly. I wouldn't say it's from Oakland, but I will not say that. And what is happening?
Yeah. Tail.
You see it, guys?
Yeah.
It happens really fast when you have a lot of dogs.
What does the other guy do with his tail? Oh, yeah, immediately, yeah? Oh, what did he do?
Couple more bows.
What did the other do? Stiffened up, stretched out his legs. We are in a transition phase right now. What did he do? Bay play bow. What did the other do? Stiffened and raises his hackles even more.
So does the white dog know he's getting ready to fight him?
Hey, well.
What kind of dog is that?
Lucky dog. What is happening in the background? And this is about the distance that you're going to see this from this far distance, so you better have good eyes. Because if you're in your dog park, it's going to happen really quickly. These dogs are already stiffening up. This guy's tail is up here, and here's a German Shepherd. What happened? They stiffened up. Okay. Kick this owner in the balls, please. Because what is he doing? He's setting his dog up for failure. He's already punishing his dog for protecting himself. Okay? Ah, the pit bull got it, eh?
Paka!
You know when to run it, don't you?
There he goes, the hackles go back up, he's just loading. Now the little squirrel. I'm bigger than you.
Just a puppy.
Old guy scared shitless, eh, for his little dog. Dog parks are fun.
Why is he just walking around recording
him? I'm sorry?
Why is he just walking around recording
him? I know. I'm glad he did. It's educational for every one of us. We're gonna have ads again.
Goodwill, a pretty good
YouTube sucks right now. So much ads.
But did you know that Goodwill is good?
Come here.
Play bow, stiff. Got bitten in the eye by the shepherds.
Oh, he scratched your eye, didn't he? He bit your eye. Come on, man, it's time to go.
fast forward this year.
He just got attacked by a shepherd. Yeah, he's bleeding right now. Yep, there you go. That's what happened last time. Nate, hey!
No, it's not.
How old are your dogs?
She's 10
5. Oh, okay, so they're pretty mature.
Yeah.
You're still a puppy.
Yeah, I don't think you're around each other. It sounds worse than it is.
Yeah, oh yeah, of course.
But yeah, some dogs you can come out here.
Yeah.
They are pretty aggressive. But once
you
can freak out
from a dog, you see why I left this in the video? You see the stiff behavior?
Mm-hmm. No, hey, no.
Okay, so.
Shoot and shake correct them?
Yeah.
Maybe, no. No.
And it's still the same dog, but you kind of get the idea of the.
The Xfinity Black Friday sales event is happening now. Get $200 back when you get Wi-Fi speeds faster than a gig. Okay, let's watch this again, and then let's talk about what not to do. So what did I say about raising the feet? Yeah. So one of the things that we need to prevent is that, like, do not step in front of the dog. One of the things that we need to do is always raise the back feet. We grab the dogs by the back feet and we lift them up that way. What's going to happen is the dog is going to let go and see what the hell is lifting him up. That means that he's going to try to bite you. Yeah. At that particular moment, when he turns around, you can de-escalate, grab him by the collar, put him down. Yeah, big dogs, a little bit more difficult. Don't start yelling at the dog. Why? Ah, because they're barking. I said, you're barking with him. I said, are you fighting with me or against me? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we kind of reinforce our the arousal stuff. So especially in this situation, you know, you have so many dogs, and one of the reasons that it happens here is why. Well, it's on a leash, but they can't go anywhere. Yeah, they're in a very enclosed space. It's at a gate. People are lined up. The dogs feel trapped, and then you know, these things happen. And then this is the reason why I put this video in here. Is why I hate dog parks, you know, because people are lifting their dogs up. Their dogs are, like, so many dogs are walking stiff around. They're looking to rank. There's no good communication going on. I mean, this guy takes his dog, and look at this clusterfuck here.
Yeah, so many people.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, what did we hear? Arrhythmic barking. What is that going to give you as a cue? Trouble is coming. And then she punishes the dog for what? For play buying. Yeah, we're going to watch this one more time. My bad. Sorry, I need to go back a little bit more. There's the play bow, and then the other one's scared, and then there's the punishment. What do we see in the first 4 seconds? What is this?
Bowing,
supple play. Exactly. Very good. Eh? Very, very nice play here. Very intense. This guy's hackles are up here. You know, he has his tail docked.
Right here.
What is the white one trying to do? This guy is not. Does not know how to play. Yeah? Yeah, he's already ranking a little bit. And then they punish the dogs that are playing, where they should have taken the other two dogs out of the play.
I'm okay if they play, it's just they go right in here somebody.
Poor guy can't hold his tail differently. What has changed here with the white dog? Boxer's like, okay, toop to you. What was that? Very stiff, eh?
Yeah.
The other one in the background also very stiff. Pitbull really stiff. Did you see the stare? Very stiff. lot just happened here. Immediately postures, yeah? So this is not an initiation to play already. This is going to be something else. What did the boxer say? I understood your message. Thank you very much. I'll turn around. Oh, big dog. I'm going to take my little dog off. Very awful, eh? So, what was this?
He's really good at reading their communication, huh?
Who?
The boxer.
The boxer's really good. What is going on here? This is territorial. Yeah? This is my part of the park there, buddy. And the boxer says, okay, I understand the message. Growling, loose, play bow. The other one in the back, a little bit stiffer. See the play bow, waff. Play bow back. And the other one stiffs. I want to play too, I'm the biggest, bigger than you. Dogs. Dumbest thing you can ever do is take a toy into a dog park and play with your own dog with a toy. If you want to induce aggression, that's a really good way to do it. Because now everybody wants the toy from the chasing dog. Bark in the background, frustration, very rhythmic, very sequential, woof, woof, woof. Sorry. Oh, you guys like commercials? What happened? It happened a little bit further. Okay. It started here. Yeah. It started here. There's posturing towards each other already. Yeah? And then hang on. These two are posturing towards each other. Posture again. Posture, posture, and then boom. So somebody knew what he was doing to bring a football horn. It really works. If your dogs are a little sensitive to, you know, to that, it's a very salient stimulation. So in, okay, in my video, talk about the salient order of stimulation. That sound was way more salient than their contact, their tactical stimulation that they had. So what did you hear about the growl? What did you hear about the bark? It's arrhythmic, it's deeper, it changed, yeah? You see the eyes, they stare, these guys posture, and then this is what I wanted you to see. As his hair is up on his back and his tail. The German Shepherd would have said, I mean, I'm going to go in next. Okay, so what if we learned in these couple videos already? Did we see the behavior? One is there a thing that stands out to you, Amy, from watching all these little clips?
I think from the distance, the hair rising, the bushy tail is the easiest thing.
Yeah, that's the easiest, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, looking at the ass of the dog, and we could see a very consistent change in these dogs from hackles to the front to hackles to the back. The problem with most people is they see hackles to the front, they're already panicking. And we had never seen any weird encounter with dogs that had hackles in the front, because that is just arousal. It's the same with people. It's the same with communication directed to people. It's not because your dog raises the hackles towards you when the hackles are in the front as he's about to maul you. He's just very aroused to see you. You know, when his ass starts poking up a little bit and his tail gets thicker, well, maybe go get another dog, yeah. But then he's about to, tell you that he's ready to challenge you to fight, yeah. We've seen a lot of play bouts. We see similarities. Was what? Growling, barking, dominant paws. That in a play did not lead to a fight, but then as soon as the dog starts posturing up, a dominant paw leads to what? A challenge. Yeah? So we have very similar behaviors in playing and fighting, and it is us that, you know, our trained eye need to make that decision. Yeah? So I have two optional videos that we're gonna watch. It's one of my favorite animal behaviorists. Yeah, I like to kick him in the teeth once in a while. So let's go to an aggressive dog and show you what not to do, okay?
This is Cowboy and Otter. Thanks to Wisdom Panel, we now know they're part border collie, with a genetic marker for medication sensitivity. Wisdom Panel is the most accurate dog DNA test. No more, care better.
Attention, do you have Medicare? Did you know that you may qualify to get up to $144 at...
Pepin, how to correct him?
Hey. Hey.
Caesar? Nature's next 911 call.
I'll be right back.
Motorcycle buddies, Robo and Adam, who live in fear of their friend Evan's aggressive German shepherd.
Can you maybe
tell him
to the little
chop
here?
It's outside, yeah.
Meet him the first time I met him. He was really cool, really friendly. And the next day, he was barking at another one of our friends.
And I'm like, oh, there's five dogs in there.
No problem. I step over to the meat dog. He takes a bite out of my hand. Yeah, meat dog totally has a scar on my hand. I think about it every day now.
After a dog targets human, it's actually very dangerous.
If I had to get rid of Mito, I think it'd be pretty devastating. I wouldn't want to see that.
So what's the best way for me to see Amigo?
Well, this is Evan's garage, and he's on his way back here with Amigo, okay. So actually we should clear out.
Let's go.
Caesar, Robo, and Adam wait across the street.
So right here, this is where we're gonna look at him?
Yeah.
Until Evan and Amigo arrive.
That's Evan, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go. Oh, here comes another dog. Oh my God, he's not territory.
Yeah. So now watch what happens when we go in.
Right. He's already warning him. But he's licking his mouth.
What's up? Come on in.
Caesar was called by Robo and Adam, who are afraid to hang out with their friend Evan because of his aggressive German Shepherd mix, Amigo.
We need help.
He's bitten before, and now Caesar watches from a distance as the men approach.
You warned them. That doesn't... He didn't just change, okay? He didn't just change. He warned you guys. He warned. He warned.
So here, we're excited to see you.
What's up, man? What's up?
Boy, you're a hard guy to get a hold of.
My name's Evan Zeller. My dog is Amigo. He's a 6-year-old German Shepherd mix. I grew up in New York City.
Probably with an Australian Shepherd looking at the build.
It's time to get a dog. So I wanted to try and find a dog that was interesting looking. I always wanted a wolf, but you can't really have a wolf, especially living in a city. So to me, Amigo was the best of both worlds, at least I thought. When I first brought Amigo home, initially he was a sweetheart. You could tell he was pretty excited to be out of the rescue. And my dad walked by him to go upstairs, and Amigo like bites on his ankle. And for me, that was like, okay, all right, Amigo, you got one strike. The second week I have Amigo, and I bring him into work. He bit one of my coworkers, the IT guy, my boss, the global head of analytics. He definitely punctured his book skin. After Amigo got expelled from work, I thought, okay, it's time for some serious training. I worked with a trainer a few weeks, a month or two. I think I got Amigo to a good place for a while. And next thing I know, my buddy's like, ow, 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 and Amigo's on his elbow. You know, three strikes, right? Oh, man. Before I had Amigo, my friends would come over, we'd work on bikes, we had barbecues, it was no big deal. So now he won't let my guy friends in the garage. It's definitely changed, you know, how I hang out with my friends. I work by myself now, and sometimes, you know, a couple extra hands would be nice to have around the garage. You know, I think a lot of people would say, well, just get rid of him, return him back to the rescue. I mean, hey, at one point I talked to them about just bringing him back. And I think you gotta be real that not everything in life is perfect. And sometimes the tough things are worth working through. And that's where I'm at. You know, I don't wanna give up on this dog because he hasn't given up on me.
So what I do, hey. That's incredible.
Right.
You're all right with this guy?
Not yet. With me, he's like, the vibe is different.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
He was like, he's like, dude, what? I'm telling you from over there. I'm telling you not to come in.
Yeah.
Silently, he told you. Obviously, that's not what people pick up. You know? Yeah. People don't pick up the little messages. People see barking, teeth, lunging, and then people say, what's wrong with this dog? You know, it's bipolar. No, it's a dog was communicating, the human didn't listen. Amigo's aggressiveness can be prevented if Evan and his friends learn to read his body language so they can see the warning signs.
Look, his ears are back, tail is low. That's a good sign, ears are back.
Right.
When I came in first, his eyes were on me. When the ears are up, they're already zooming in you. Like a sniper, it's already on you. So Evan, that's what you need to be looking out for when your friends arrive.
And I feel better now. Doo, 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 doo.
Luckily for Evan, Amigo is easy to read.
Yeah, so what I do.
Hey, but Evan is not the only one who needs to learn the signs. Right now, I can see Amigo feels threatened by the energy of these two friends who have come into his space.
Can we leave?
Yeah, yeah. I need to show them how they are contributing to the problem.
Look how you're watching it. Look at it. See it?
These guys are so stiff and tense around this dog that it's making Amigo nervous, and nervous dogs lash out.
Look at those eyes.
To help them learn Amigo's warning signs, Caesar uses a wooden crate to test him.
It's all right. Hey. So he gets nervous. Look. There's a box. It's not even me.
All right.
Hey, now Evan, do me a favor. Go outside.
Caesar has Evan leave to work alone with Amigo, but wants him to watch on a monitor.
Pass me my leash.
If Amigo acts out again, the same way he does around Evan's friends, Caesar wants to show Evan how to correct him.
Hey.
It's all cute and cuddly. Yeah.
All right, but now I have to respond back. If he throws a punch, I have to be able to correct that. So I can block the brain before the brain gets into that level. That's why you have a leash.
When Amigo lashes out like that, a quick correction and follow through is how Evan can teach Amigo that attacking is not okay.
There you go, right there. See that? Hey.
Yeah, I see all that.
That's the alert part.
This is what Evan has to do when his friends come around. I corrected him when his ears were up as he was getting excited, but before he attacked.
So you have to learn to avoid first. You'll be okay if he's avoiding you.
Okay, so...
Oh, yes. You're not okay if he's in a fight state.
Let it.
Then he learned to surrender. Yeah, this is consummate state. This is what you want.
This is crazy. Wow. You know, I thought it was this big thing where it was going to take lots of time and wait around, and it was instant.
Dude, that was like 5 minutes.
Amigo was just chilling. I saw him on the monitor, just smiling, hanging out.
It's happy, right? This is a happy state right there. Look, he's using his nose. This is what you want. You see the eyes like that?
So this is what we call learned helplessness with this guy. So everything that we watched in the video is, I'll hopefully we can watch it again. Oh my God, sorry. Where am I?
Evan, how to correct him?
Let's skip through all the bullshit.
Territory, dogs.
So now watch what happens when we go in.
I hate the show because it's all staged.
He's already won.
So one of the things, what is happening with the dog? Where is the dog, and in what setting is the dog?
In his own space.
No, he's tied into a room that he can't escape from. Okay, he's leashed up from a room that he can't escape from. Yeah, what does restraining do? We have seen it in the other videos.
Frustration,
agitation. So, what does the dog's eyes look like? Wide. What does the dog's ear look like? Yeah, they're like 10 past 2 to a quarter past 3.
Oh, he's licking his mouth.
What's up? Come on in.
And then he's very... Oh my God.
Attention, do you have Medicare? Did you know that you may qualify to get up to 100...
Caesar was called by Robo and Adam, who are a...
Boy, you're a hard guy to get a hold of.
My name's Evan Zeller.
That's incredible.
Right.
You're all right with this guy?
Not yet. With me, he's the...
So here what's happening is the dog is showing avoidance to him. I mean, I know a little bit about the behind the scenes from this this show, which, you know, Google for yourself, and then you know what the tss means, or the click click and the zap zap. That's how they condition the tss. You put an e-collar on it, you do tss, and you get zapped. You do an e-collar on it, tss, and you get zapped. And then there's a magic man, yeah?
Oh, that's how. Tss,
and the dog is already, oh shit, I'm going to get zapped. Yeah? So it takes a couple weeks of conditioning, then they record the show. It's really awesome. Yeah? So anyway, so then there's the magic guy.
I was different.
Yeah, totally.
He was like this.
The dog's in complete avoidance, ear back, tail down, paws narrow, super anxious.
He's like, dude, what?
I'm telling you from over there, I'm telling him not to come in. Yeah. Silently, he told you. Obviously, that's not what
the people that have been in my body language class, you know, you'll see the steps. He doesn't step open, he steps like this. Sideways, he tries to keep his body as small as possible, which is a sign of avoidance and extreme stress.
Yeah, people don't pick up the little messages. People see barking, teeth, lunging, and then people say, what's wrong with this dog? You know, it's bipolar.
No, there is small Mexican.
The human
I said it live.
Amigo's aggressiveness can be prevented if Evan and his friends learn to read his body language so they can see.
So what is the body language here? Total avoidance, yeah? Absolute total avoidance.
Warning signs.
Look, his ears are back, tail is low. That's a good sign, ears are back.
Right.
When I came in first, his eyes were on me. When the ears are up, they're already zooming in you.
And it was not on him, it was on the umbrella.
On you.
Yeah.
So not on him.
That's what you need to be looking out for when your friends arrive. Luckily for Evan, Amigo is easy to read.
So what I
hey, but Evan is not the only one who needs to learn the sign. Enough for when your friends arrive. Luckily for Evan, Amigo is easy to read.
So what I
hey.
He did it, and what?
Yeah.
There's the shock collar. Yeah? As soon as it says, I'll tie one of my dogs on the and do go do it. That's why I would love to have him over here. He said, hey man, I have an aggressive dog.
Try cheesy crispy Ritz cheese crispers.
Okay, say again.
Why are we giving kids churros?
I have no idea. So, so the reason why I put one of these shows on is because it's a resource that a lot of people watch, you know, and unfortunately there's not good resources available
where they explain like the correct body language. So we need to be very careful that when we look at something that we don't interpret, you know, that we don't take this as, oh, it's on National Geographic, so it's probably the truth. Yeah, it's not. So what I try to do today is with a couple of, you know, with some explanation and go over some real videos. Yeah, I decided to keep the really bloody video out because people were shocked. I can show it when people say I want to see it. It's a very gruesome dogfight. So what I try to do today is show you the difference between play and fighting, and how difficult it is for us as humans to actually make the correct decisions in either in encourage it, reinforce the play, even interact with it, play with the dogs, or intervene and try to prevent the fight. So the things that we need to look out for is suppleness in the body versus stiffness. Yeah, and then what's the other one? Come on, give it to me.
Hackles at the tail.
Hackles at the tail. What's the biggest one?
Posture,
yes. Yeah, posture or the play bow. The bow versus posture. Those are the two things. So bow versus posture, and then stiffness versus suppleness. Then the other big indicator is the hackles. Hackles in the front or hackles in the back. Stiffness in the tail or suppleness in the tail. So once our eyes start recognizing these signals, we can hopefully become a little bit less afraid or tense. Because one of the biggest issues that we have is, like, for instance, if like Amy has three dogs and they're big dogs, and then one dog might be more intense than the other. If the game starts looking intense and they're growling and barking, however, we don't see any of the other signs, if we then break up that game, and this is what I think is happening at home, is then the dog might form associations with the other dog to your negative intervenience. It's because of Fluke that you intervened, and now Luke's an asshole. Does that make sense? So I hope, you know, after today you have a little bit better understanding, you know, what the difference is between play and fighting, and how we as humans can even make it worse, or, you know, we can make it a little bit better. The other thing that I try to convey is I stay out of dog parks, and I think I showed a lot of examples why, and that not all dogs play the same game. You know, some dogs, you know, play a very low-key game, other dogs play a very high-key game, and then if we tend to mix these two dogs together, often we have trouble, yeah, because ones are bullies and ones are, you know, they like to play chess instead of rugby. Having a rugby player go over a chessboard is probably not a good idea. Train yourself by watching videos. You know, just Google dog fights, dog play, start studying them, and write these all these little differences down. And look for one. Don't look for anyone. I said, today I'm going to look for play bows. Then I'm going to look for pasture. Then I'm going to look for stairs. Then I'm going to look for change in hackles, and then start combining it and see how fast you can do it. Then fast forward, you know, put your video on double speed and see if you can recognize it fast. Train your eyes, train your observation. That is how we get better. It's literally look out for videos and train yourself. Yeah? Mary, any questions? Anything you liked about, any comments, anything you liked about this video?
Oh no, it was awesome. I mean, I think the thing that stood out to me the most is just how subtle and how fast it can be. So you like go to your happy place for a nanosecond while your perfectly behaved dog on a leash is walking down the street, and if somebody's coming towards you, like it actually, you know, it makes more sense of why people say,
he's always been so good. Oh my God, he's never done that before. Because mm-hmm. it can be really subtle and it can be really fast.
Yeah, and we saw that with the at the two dogs there. Ken.
It was just a good showing of what to look for and a good reminder you just don't go to dog parks.
mm-hmm.
Not only, I think, for possible aggression, but it could be a place where your dog's going to pick up diseases.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's why I don't go to them.
Just loosen it up.
Yeah. Still go.
Okay. Anything you picked up? Anything you liked? Any questions?
Yes. First, I was kidding. Because when I came in today, I'm like, maybe I'll figure out why Goose is like a bowling ball when he tries to play.
Bowling ball.
So it was funny that you used that exact analogy. Also, my question was, okay, so if they get into a fight, you grab them by their back feet? Or like the
behind,
knees? Or?
Behind the feet. So what I normally do is how to break up a dog fight is I'll try to loop a leash at the midsection, at the belly, and then lift their back feet up. If I don't have one, I'll grab the dogs like that and
like
lift them up.
The belly, in front of
yeah,
the back
at the feet, yeah, and I'll lock the back feet out of place, yeah, and then lift them up like that so they go. And you need to do that simultaneous with the other dog. Do not do that with one dog because the other dog that you lift up will probably end up dead.
Okay.
Yeah, because you just exposed the throat, and then if the other dog gets it. So it needs to be done simultaneously. Okay. Yeah, you need two people, two dog owners. Okay.
A lot of time with my dogs, when they're so big, you know, that I can't, and a lot of times when they get in their tiffs, it's just me around.
Mm-hmm.
So in that situation, I find myself panicking and screaming. I need
okay.
to stop.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's just me.
An air horn will help.
Okay.
Absolutely, with your dogs. The other thing is the training that you're doing, the leadership that you're creating, the being okay with each other, the patience, the food sharing, and all that stuff, is basically what we're doing is we're teaching them that they're all equal, and their survival depends on what?
Me.
Yes. Everything in their life depends on you, you know, and that helps a lot. Once they're into a squirrel, I mean, you got over 400 pounds of dog to deal with. You know, that's a lot of dog. So in that particular case, I think air horns and stuff will definitely help. Okay.
What about citronella spray?
Depends on the dog. You know, this like it's with pepper spray, you know. You spray pepper spray in one guy's eye and it's like, oh my God, I got something in my eye. And the other one scream like a little baby. So it really depends on the dog.
So
and
the
in
horn
and
is
the
better.
And the intensity. Say again?
So the horn is better.
Horns tend to work really well.
Okay.
Yeah, tend to work really well. Bear spray works when you're out in dog parks. And I use them on the owners.
And the kick to the balls.
And the kick to the balls. Rob, any questions?
I've encountered a situation where a couple of times I'm not a dog owner, but I've seen a couple of dog owners, dogs go at each other, and the people just freeze up and go into shock, and
yes.
The dogs are fighting, and I'm sitting there thinking, what do I do as someone who's not really, I don't actually...
By yourself in a group of dogs?
Yeah, I mean, I see that a lot. You know, a couple of people, you see the owners just freeze up, and then I think, what should I be doing right now?
A hair horn works really well.
And,
you know, and bear spray.
If I didn't have an air horn, what would you do?
It's the leash. And then, so I have broken up a dog fight with three dogs with three leashes, and I just grabbed them like that. And there were three big German shepherds.
Okay.
And then I yelled at somebody here.
Hold them by the back of their neck, or
I'm sorry?
It's okay to hold them by the back of their neck if you don't have a leash, or
where
would you?
I would always go for the back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because if you grab them by the back of the neck and then the other one jumps on and bites you instead, you have a problem. Okay. Anything? Any questions?
I think it's the same thing Mary said, that it's it seems to happen so fast, but actually they've been given the signs for quite a while. If you can train
mm-hmm.
yourself to look for them.
Exactly. Yeah. And there's hardly any surprise dog fight. You know the one that we saw at the end there, where the boxer with the black German shepherds were fighting. They started that at the table.
And it's not registering that. It's just like, oh shit, surprise. No, they've been communicating that for 15, 20 seconds that they were not happy with each other, you know? And part of it was triggered by the dog that got the toy, you know? And it's missing those pieces that will lead to disaster. Good lesson?
Very
good. What did you find?
Great information. I didn't know all the subtleties of the different, like the hackles and where it was. I had no clue. I thought the hackles were up. It was a negative thing, you know, it was an aggressive thing. But mm-hmm. Yeah, I learned a lot about that. Great tips on with the air horn and just being aware, way more aware. Mostly before I've been oblivious to all that stuff.
Good,
you know?
Good.
And we definitely avoid dog parks.
Good.
Don't go anymore.
Any other questions?
No. This is great information. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am, what did you think of the lecture?
I didn't realize how subtle some of the behaviors are that you really like. Yeah, that's a good tip to just watch the videos and practice.
Yes.
Because
and that's how you get better. Like people ask me, how did you get good in observing dogs? I said, by observing dogs. Mm-hmm. And then when you don't have access to dogs, like look for videos, you know, and study one behavioral change at a time. You know, and I do that when I do my body language classes, I do the same thing. You know, if I talk about anxiety or all that stuff, there's so many different changes is to train yourself to look is you start with one thing and then you try to speed that up and then you combine it and then that's how we get better. Okay? Good lesson?
Yeah, so I did have one question.
Yes.
The biggest issue I run into, like taking my dog places, is people having off-leash dogs that run up to her and of course they yell, oh, he's friendly, and I'm like, well, my dog's a puppy, I don't know if she is.
I always said my dog is super aggressive to other dogs and humans.
Okay.
My dog is on a leash. This is from now on your responsibility. I will sue your ass if your dog comes to mine. That helps.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah.
It really helps. Sir, any? What did you think of the lecture?
I think it was excellent. I mean, learned a lot about how fast the dogs react. Mm-hmm. And how important it is not to bring your dogs around other owners that don't know what they're doing as well.
Good. Yeah. Any more questions for me?
No.
No?
I don't think so.
Good stuff. May, did I?
Awesome, Bart. Can I follow up on her question?
Yes.
So if your dog is on a leash and an unleashed dog attacks your dog, what is the best thing to do? Just let go of the leash or?
Let go of the leash, yeah, that's a good thing. And then try to, solve the situation. If I see a dog running to my dog and I know it's going to be aggressive, I keep my dog back, and then I'm a really good soccer player.
Yeah.
I'm a really good soccer player. And that is then sad, or in that particular case, when you have bear spray with a running dog, just spray the dog and then get out of the way because... depends on the wind, you might be in for a surprise. But yeah, that's what I do. But it's sometimes safer to just let go of the leash and then let the dogs de-escalate it by themselves. They're actually better communicators than us. They're also better in interpreting what's going on. So sometimes it's better just to trust the dog. But it's also always an educational guess because we don't know any of the antecedents of the dog that comes towards us.
That seems so scary, but I've heard that you just drop the leash.
That's what I normally do.
Yeah.
But when you come with protection dogs and certified protection dogs, dropping the leash increases my liability by a lot. So I rather pray a good field goal with the other dogs. That's probably safer. Yeah. So it's really depending on the situation. Well, good. Are there any questions there online on Facebook? If not, I'm going to wrap up here for today. So we're good. And again, if you do have more questions, please post them under this video. Yeah, because these videos are live. They're in my Facebook group. You will you'll be able to rewatch it. One of the things that I'll try to do is depending on how the audio is to see if I can get the audio from the video better, but. If it's good, we'll keep it this way. And then, I'll see everybody in his next session.
Thank you so much, Facebook, for checking in. Also, leave me any questions or comments below, and I will see you in the next lecture. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you, guys.